What's up, everyone? Welcome back to my channel. I have missed you guys so much. If you are loyal to this channel or you're familiar with this channel, you know that I have basically fallen off the face of the planet, essentially. I haven't posted for over a month, I think, and it's very unusual for me, but it was really necessary for me to take a step back. I was kind of in a creative rut, and there was a lot going on in my business as well. We actually recently hired 4 new people on the team, and there's just so many things that are going on behind the scenes. But I am back on YouTube, and I figured that I would kick off with a really fun video so that people can get to know me a little bit better. For those who are familiar with me, who have followed me for a while, I've actually gotten a few DMs over the last few years of people asking about my makeup routine, what my favorite skincare products are like, and how I get ready for filming, on top of a lot of other questions that are pretty personal and don't necessarily fit in a specific video. Actually, I had a lot of people ask me questions about my boyfriend, my goals in life, all these little things. And so I figured I'd put all of that in this video for you guys. What I'll be doing is I'll literally be doing my entire makeup routine, the same routine that I do when I get ready for filming, on top of answering some major questions that you guys have asked me over the course of the few months that I have been offline and all of that. I will preface this video and let you guys know that it is gonna be a longer one, so I'm gonna add timestamps for all the questions that I answered in case there was a particular question you were specifically interested in. With that being said, let's get right into the video. All right, so right now I have no makeup on, and a question that I get asked is, what beauty routines did I automate? Because this does not look like this naturally. I definitely paid money and invested in makeup automation so that every single day I kind of look decent in my eyes, because what I realize is I'm on camera every single day pretty much. If it's not on YouTube, then it's on Instagram story. If it's not an Instagram story, then maybe it's an interview somewhere or a conference or a summit or something like that. And I realized that I was spending 45 minutes every single day to put on my makeup. And if I didn't put on my makeup, I would feel like it would impact my consistency. I wouldn't feel confident showing my face online and all those different things. And so the things that I have automated are my eyebrows. They are microbladed, lash extensions, lip blushing. It's basically, instead of having pale lips, you kind of tattoo some color in it so that it's semi-permanent. All the time my lips have some sort of color. I still wear lipstick and I still wear everything like that, but naturally it looks like I have a little bit of makeup on. Another thing, if we want to get real, is I also do preventative Botox as well. And this was something that actually I never realized that I would want. But over time, I realized that I was filming so many videos, talking all the time, more than the average person. And when you talk a lot, you get, you know, smile lines, you get crow's feet, you get the lines right here, because I'm so expressive when I'm filming videos. And so now I also invest money in preventative Botox to prevent, you know, the aging process, or at least to slow it down. No hate in the comment section, just wanted to be candid with you. There's also other cosmetic procedures that I've done in the past, but I don't really necessarily feel comfortable sharing everything on YouTube because that's not what my niche is about. But if you have any questions, feel free to DM me on Instagram about cosmetic procedures and all of that, and I'm more than happy to share. I have nothing to hide. I just don't feel comfortable sharing every little detail on YouTube. And so that's the answer to that question. And then the next question that we have is, what are my favorite beauty products, whether that's skincare, lipstick, makeup, and all of that. So I have everything in front of me. I've already done my hair, I've already done my skincare routine, and we're gonna focus on makeup today. But before we do that, I wanna share some of my favorite skincare products. The first one is my holy grail. This is Biotherm Life Plankton Essence. And I learned about this product when I did my internship at L'Oreal. My previous corporate job, I was a marketing assistant at L'Oreal. And before that, I was a marketing intern. And this was the first brand that I ever interned with. And I got a hold of their products, and this is the one that stuck with me for years. When I did my internship, it was back in 2014 or 2015. So it's been a long time since I've been introduced to this product, and every single time I go back to it, this is like almost empty, and this is probably like my 10th bottle. My skin used to be so bad. I used to have eczema, and because of my eczema, I was prescribed this steroid cream. And the steroid cream was magical. If I put it on any blemish, it would go away. It's supposed to be for eczema only, but over time I loved it so much, so I started putting it all over my face. I mixed it in with my moisturizer, and what I didn't realize is that steroid cream actually thins out your skin. And so over time I was thinning out my skin, and my skin started breaking, and it looks like this. I had really bad skin, and the only thing that fixed it was this. This is incredible. It kind of smells like feet, but I love this product so much to the point where when I used to work at L'Oreal, they actually made me like almost the poster girl for this product. And the Biotherm YouTube channel actually has a video of me promoting this product for one of their social media campaigns.
I'll show you my step zero to any skincare routine.
So that is how much I love this product. The second thing that I love using is this sunscreen right here. I wear sunscreen almost every single day, and this is the one that the Kardashians use, actually, and that's how I heard about it. My friend Teresa also recommended it to me, and it's one of those sunscreens where you put it on and it just feels so lightweight, and you don't really feel like you're wearing sunscreen. It feels like a moisturizer. And so this is something that I use all the time. It's empty. So all the things that I'm showing you are actually my holy grail products because they're empty and I use them all the time. The third product that I want to share with you is this retinoid oil. I put this on every other night, and essentially it helps with fine lines and it helps with anti-aging and all that. It's not necessarily retinol, it's retinoid. And don't ask me what the difference is, but I use this every other night for my night care routine. And then my night care routine every single night, I use this mask from Alginist, and it also is like pretty much empty. Everything I use is empty because it's so good. This is a collagen mask that I put on every single night. A little goes a long way. It's super heavy, but when I wake up, my skin is just so nice. And so those are kind of my holy grail products. As you'll notice, I don't really have a daytime cream that I recommend. I actually haven't really found one that I liked, but the things that I'm showing you today are literally my holy grail empties. On top of this Laneige lip mask as well, I use this day and night. This is how good it is. And it's also like pretty much empty. And so with that out of the way, let me actually put some lip chap on. I start with this for my makeup routine before I do anything, is put it on my lip balm. Otherwise I feel weird. So there's that. And then over time, as I do my makeup, I'll show you guys the products that I use and answer the next few questions. And so while I do my makeup routine, the next question that I see right in front of me is, how did I meet my boyfriend? What business does he do? And how do you balance your relationship and business? How I met my boyfriend was, we actually went to high school together. He's 3 years older than me. And by the way, right now I'm putting on my concealer. This is the Bare Minerals Pro. It is my favorite concealer. It is so good. But yeah, we went to school together. I met him when I was in grade 9 and he was in like grade 12 or 11 or something like that. We started dating. And, you know, when I started graduating high school, I realized that I didn't want to be with him anymore. And so I broke up with him. There's more to the story, but basically I had broken up with him because I was headed into university and I thought that there'd be more fish in the sea. And at the time, I really wanted to date like a consultant or investment banker and whatever. And so we broke up. But throughout the years, we started seeing each other pretty much every single year after we broke up. We were never official or anything like that. But we were just seeing each other all the time. Eventually, it got to a place where we were always seeing each other and it was preventing me from moving forward with any other relationship. I realized that even though people check all the boxes on paper, sometimes you don't have that connection or chemistry, or there's other things other than financial, career, all those things that are important when you look for someone. And so I realized that there's no one else in the world like my boyfriend that makes me laugh the way that I do, that understands me the way that I do, and that makes me feel comfortable. And so that's when I realized, hey, yeah, we either have to make the decision to officially be together or we need to stop seeing each other, point blank period, because I can't do this anymore. No, I'm filming a video. I'm embarrassed. Stop listening. And by the way, what I just put on my face is Selena Gomez's beauty line. This is Rare Beauty. It is their blush and I really like it. So this is kind of the technique that I use. I don't know where I learned it from. Maybe it's probably TikTok, but essentially what I do is I put concealer first and then I put my liquid blush and then I start blending it out together. And so it's a really weird thing, but it works for me. And so what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna take this black beauty blender. It's specifically meant to blend my blush while I have another beauty blender that does my concealer. And so this is going to, you know, spread the blush all over and then I'm gonna finish off with my concealer. But anyways, so we decided to make the decision of whether or not we actually wanted to be together or not. Originally, my boyfriend actually said no, he didn't want to be together. And the reason why he said that is because at the time I already had secured a full-time job at L'Oreal and where I would have to literally move across the country. And by the way, I know this looks crazy, but trust the process. And he didn't want to do long distance with me. And so that was his decision. And I was like, you know what? That's fine. I guess we just need to stop talking to each other and that's it. I'll never talk to you again. It's the end. But then a few weeks later, I was at like a party where I met this guy and we were hitting it off really well and all that. He was basically my date for this like sorority function that I was at. And we were at a club and obviously we were drinking alcohol and having a good time. And all of a sudden I get this phone call from like a random number because I deleted my boyfriend's number from my phone. And by the way, I know I look crazy. And I pick up and my boyfriend's just basically like, I made a mistake. You made me happy. I don't know what I was thinking about. I'm willing to do long distance with you.
can we talk and all of that. And so then he drove all the way to the club and he asked me to be his girlfriend. Now, it's funny because to this day, I tell my boyfriend that if I didn't drink alcohol that night, I probably would have said no because I didn't want to go back on my word, which was, you know what, if we're over, we're over, and there's no chance that you can get me back again. But because I had some alcohol in my system, I realized that that was truly what I wanted. And that incident happened like over 5 years ago, almost 6 years ago. And we have been going strong ever since. That's the story of me and my boyfriend. And then another question that was asked was, what business does he do? So a lot of you guys who follow me on Instagram obviously have seen some behind the scenes and stuff of me mentioning that my boyfriend has an e-commerce business. Well, specifically, he sells on Amazon and he's very secretive of the products that he sells. He doesn't necessarily want me to share it with you guys because Amazon is a very, very competitive space. It's very easy for people to hijack your products, especially if they know that you're successful. And so he doesn't like it when I tell people what products he sells. So I'm not going to say that. I do know that he's not interested in like selling courses or teaching people or doing what I do. And so he's just happy with having his e-commerce Amazon business. He also is a seven-figure business owner, which is really, really cool. And that leads to the next question that I saw, which was, does your boyfriend ever help you with your business? It's really funny because in the beginning, he helped me a lot. Like he was the one who introduced me to this book by Russell Brunson. And that book literally opened my eyes to online marketing. I read that book right after I quit my corporate job and I got super inspired and all that. He also helped me with getting my website up and running, like all the little tech stuff he was helping me with. And now as I've grown in business, I'm helping him. Like I'm helping him with figuring out how he needs to run his meetings and, you know, all the processes and systems that we use. I literally share it with him and all of that. And so it's really cool how we help each other. And that also leads to the next question of, how does your boyfriend feel dating a millionaire? I'm a millionaire in terms of like my net worth and my assets and all that, but I'm personally like not paying myself $1 million out of my business. I reinvest a lot of it back to my business and expanding my business. I don't think he feels anything different because he is also like a seven-figure business owner. And so I really truly feel like I have met my partner and my equal. And sometimes a lot of people ask me like, how do you find a partner that is just as ambitious as you and all of that? And for me, I think what works really well with me and my boyfriend specifically is we dated each other when we had nothing, right? Like we weren't rich by any means. We weren't business owners by any means. And we just really grew together. And I know that for me, what's most important or what I look for in a relationship is essentially that they have ambition. You could be working at McDonald's, but as long as you have like a plan for yourself and you want to do better, that's okay with me. You don't need to be a millionaire right now. I'm really looking for qualities instead of what you have in the bank at that moment. And then another question that I got about my boyfriend is, would you ever do business with your significant other? And the answer is yes. Actually, my boyfriend and I were thinking of starting a business together. We tried doing it like last year, we kind of dabbled in it and it didn't really work out because we realized that we both are so busy managing our current businesses. And so in the future, I would love to start a business with my boyfriend. And that's something that we've talked about. But right now, my focus and his focus is developing our existing businesses, his e-commerce business and my course digital education business. So anyways, as you can see, I still look a little bit crazy, but what I did was I just blended my blush first and then I blended my concealer afterwards. And now I'm gonna add my foundation. So I basically do every single thing backwards and that's just how I roll. So what I'm gonna put on as a foundation is this product right here. I actually worked for this brand. This was the last brand that I worked for when I worked at L'Oreal and this was the product that I was meant to launch. But I decided to quit my job right before and so I didn't get a chance to launch the product, but I did help with creating the Canadian compliant version of the packaging and all of that. But unfortunately, I wasn't at the company anymore, so I couldn't see this product to fruition. But it's really interesting because I was so excited about launching this product and I almost didn't want to quit my job because of it. I was like, oh my gosh, maybe after this one project, I'll then quit my job and all that. But I realized over time that there's always going to be projects. And a huge learning lesson was I thought that this project was totally screwed. Like I thought this product was never going to go to market in Canada because of me, which is so dumb. But at the time when I worked my 9-to-5, I literally thought that this whole product was riding on me, little marketing manager over here. But the truth is that the business still went on. They found my replacement really quickly. And months later, I went to a Sephora and this product was right there, ready to go in perfect condition. Nothing happened. The marketing, the merchandising was all amazing. And I realized then that I was just a little small fish in a really big ocean at L'Oreal. And I didn't necessarily need to feel like,
a whole product line was dependent on me. And so that was a big learning lesson that I learned. But anyways, what I'm going to do now is I'm going to put my foundation. This is actually technically a CC cream on my beauty blender. This is how much I put on. And then I'm going to put it around my face. And eventually what you'll notice is that this crazy blush is going to tone down. And that's kind of how I create that really like rosy effect on my face, especially for filming. I want to look youthful and I don't necessarily want to look washed out. Okay, so I just turned on my light. So hopefully the lighting is a little bit better because I literally could not even see myself in the mirror. But like I said, I'm just going to put this foundation all over my face and then my cheeks last to kind of tone down the redness. And the next question that I have is, where do you see your life or business by the age of 30? And what else do you want to do before then? Honestly, I'm 27 now. I mean, I'm turning 27 this year. I was born in 94. And I know that there was a question that asked me how old I am. I'm turning 27. And so 30 doesn't seem that far away. And so I honestly feel very happy with where I'm at in my life right now. Obviously, the next goal in my life is like to get married, buy a house and all of that, maybe take my relationship to the next level. And I'm also really interested in investing in other businesses, potentially real estate. So that's kind of like the next step for me, I would say, is financial literacy. Like I already have pretty good financial literacy, but it's taking that to the next level. Because what I realize is when you start having a business that's successful, you have like a lot of money to work with. And not only does most of that money need to go back into your business, but if you have millions of dollars or like a hundred thousands of dollars sitting in a bank account, not really collecting any interest whatsoever, you're really losing a lot of that money to inflation. And so that's kind of what I'm realizing. And so the next step for me is really to like really go ham on the investment side of things so that I don't lose a lot of the money to inflation. And so that's kind of what I see myself doing. I also see myself launching like an e-commerce brand in the future, nowhere near now, because I realize that I still have a lot of work to do with this business. But I really want to create a business that doesn't necessarily rely on me showing up every single day, like front facing. So what I do right now is like, I always have to be on Instagram stories, do YouTube videos and all that, which I really enjoy right now. But I know eventually I'm going to want to have kids. I'm going to want to do other things. And I might not be able to dedicate a lot of time to this. Obviously, I still want to, and I still want to develop and grow this business, but I want to leverage my brand for other things as well outside of just digital education. I think that's like a really great start and I really love what I do right now, but I want to create like an actual physical product that I can scale up, eventually even maybe sell that business. I don't know. I just think that the possibilities are endless and I think that that would really be the next challenge for me, but I don't see myself doing that anytime soon. It's just more so maybe by the time I'm 30, I would love to have that figured out at least. So as you can see right now, like everything is toned down. I have that like natural blush and little kind of like a natural rosy cheek feel, but it doesn't look crazy anymore. So that's kind of my routine there. My concealer is blended and everything. That's kind of what I do. The next question that I have here is, for someone who is busy, do you take naps? Curious to know your sleep schedule. I used to actually always take naps in university, but I don't take naps anymore. And I don't know why. I just don't feel like the need to take naps. The only times that I do take naps is when I'm really burnt out in business. What I mean by that is like, I'm literally feeling in a slump and it's not necessarily me taking a nap because I'm tired. It's more so taking a nap because I am in avoidance mode and I just don't want to deal with reality. And dreams are literally better than reality at that point. It doesn't have to happen often, but those are the usual only times that I take a nap. You also asked the question about what is my sleep schedule? I sleep 8 hours a day, sometimes 9. My schedule is usually I sleep around midnight and then I wake up at 8. And then on Monday, Wednesday, Friday, I go to the gym by 9. And so that's kind of why I have to wake up at 8. And ever since I got Nugget, my cute little dog, in the morning I have to walk her. And so 8 a.m. wake up consistently every single day, even on weekends actually, is really good for me. I know some people are like, oh, you got to wake up at 5 a.m. You got to do all these things. No. Like 8 is early for me. And so I'm really happy with what the schedule I have right now. And when I start work, it's usually around 11. And then I work all the way until 7 or 8. And I eat dinner pretty late, actually. I eat dinner around like 8:30. And so that's kind of my schedule there. And then every day at 12 p.m., my boyfriend and I always just have lunch together. He's actually on the other side of this wall. He has an office similar to this one, but in his style, essentially like at 12 p.m. every single day on weekdays, at least, we go for lunch at home downstairs. I'm going to use my Charlotte Tilbury powder and then just powder my face. The next question that I have here is, what is your happiest and most disliked part about running a business? I think my most favorite part of running a business is essentially creating. I love creating like PDFs. I love being in Canva. I just love doing that stuff. I love creating new lessons for Bossgram Academy, my program. Filming is like a love-hate relationship. I love doing this right now. Like, I'm so happy with what I'm doing right now here. I think it's such a fun video for me. Even if it tanks, it's fine. Creating is really my zone of genius. And I kind of am trying to set up my business where I hire everyone to do the operations, to do the managing, to do all those things that I can do, but I don't really love to do, so that I can focus on creating. When it comes to a business, my zone of genius is marketing and sales. And I love doing a lot of the front-facing things, like creating free content, building our email list, thinking of all these marketing strategies. That's kind of my favorite part about running a business. And it's also the impact that you see yourself making. So over time, especially if you've been in business for a while and you've worked with a lot of clients and you service them, just seeing the impact that you're making on other people is literally priceless and reminds me every day why I left my corporate job. Because even though I could make an impact, you know, at my corporate job, I feel like I'm making a way bigger impact now on my terms. So that is the most fulfilling thing about having a business, and just knowing how much you've grown as a person too. When you start doing your own business, you'll be so shocked by your growth trajectory. It's insane. And I can talk about that like later on in this video too. My least favorite part about running a business is the uncomfortable decisions. It's things that I hate doing at the moment, but those are the things where afterwards I'm like, wow, I'm really glad I did that. And like, wow, like I've grown a lot. So when you start having a business, you start managing a team, you know, sometimes you're gonna have some team members who maybe don't do the things that you would like them to do. And you really need to have a lot of self-awareness and figure out, okay, what am I doing wrong to prevent this person from succeeding? What process in my business needs to be fixed? And it's that problem solving that can be really uncomfortable. And when you start becoming a leader in business, you have to have so much self-awareness of like where your faults are. It's really fulfilling afterwards when you kind of have those breakthrough moments. But during that time, it's so painful to put your ego aside and actually realize that you're the one that's screwing things up, that you're the one that's the bottleneck, that you're the one that's preventing your team to be A players. I think that is not necessarily my least favorite part in business, but it's the most uncomfortable part of business. Having crazy self-awareness, you realize like, oh wow, maybe I am a shitty person. Even though I'm not a shitty person, but it's just feeling like you are because you're responsible for the growth of other people. And because you're the leader, you have to take so much accountability, so much responsibility. Another thing too, is that when you have like a personal brand-based business like me, when, you know, Susie on your team accidentally posts the wrong thing, or Allie on your team like made the wrong call or whatever, at the end of the day, your customers, your clients, your followers, whoever it is, they look at you. They don't look at Susie or Allie, and they shouldn't be. You are 100% responsible for anything that goes on in your business. Again, that's not something that I don't like doing. It's just one thing that's super uncomfortable when you actually have a business. So what I've done is I've powdered my face. I've mattified it. I have a little bit of like blush glow. My concealer's on. This sounds like a really redundant step, but I realized that I probably should have put a little bit more of this because I kind of really like the rosy cheek effect. And I also like it across my nose as well. So what I'm going to do, especially on camera, when people can't really see your makeup as well as in person, I'm going to use this Jouer Blush Duo, Marigold and Rose Petal. It's super dirty. And then I'm just going to like mix this and put it on the apples of my cheeks up here. And yeah, so that's what I'm going to do. The next question that I have here is, did you ever own a vision board that said, I will make $1 million? Yeah, but it wasn't even like $1 million. It was $100,000. So I'm going to show you in the next like bit after I finish putting on my blush, this check that I wrote for myself, and I hadn't even started a business yet. So this check is a check that I wrote for myself while I was still in my 9-to-5, and I was just so miserable and I wanted to just do something else, but I didn't know what I wanted to do. I wrote this check for $100,000. I'm going to show you right now, actually, because by the way, this is the blush. It's in this notebook right here. There's like literally nothing in this notebook. I'm like notorious for having notebooks and not writing in them. But this was a time when I was still in my 9-to-5 and I wrote down all the things that I wanted to accomplish right here in like 2016. I wanted $18,000 saved in my emergency fund, as you can see. And now it's like crazy to even see this, that $18,000 was my goal. And I thought that it would take me such a long time to have that goal together. Like, saving up $18,000. Insane. For me, at least, now that I'm looking back on it. This is a check for $100,000. And I said that I wanted to make $100,000 by the time I was 30. And I dated it for 2024. This is insane to me. And the reason why it's insane to me is because I know a lot of people, this is their goals. And I don't want to like say anything that would offend anyone that has a similar goal to this. I think you should aim for this. But for me, now that I have a business, I wrote this in 2016, okay? So now it's 2021. 5 years later, $100,000 is what my business makes in 2 weeks. Like, it's crazy. Sometimes even in 1 week, we make this much. And I thought that I would be waiting until I was 30 to make this type of income. This type of income is probably what I would have made it in my 30s if I stayed in corporate and if I stayed climbing up the corporate ladder. And so when I look at this, I'm just like shell-shocked that I was able to far exceed this beyond my wildest dreams. I'm employing other people in my company and paying their salaries full-time with benefits, all these things. In this book, I also did like a little vision board collage thing here so I can show you guys. I said I wanted to be like a director, a vice president, and then eventually a founder, a CEO. Well, your girl skipped all of this and went straight to this, which is insane. So now I can call myself a founder and CEO. I didn't think that it'd be a founder and CEO like, actually no, I did think of founder and CEO of starting my own company, but vice president and director, I literally thought it would be like at another company. This was also really like downtime in my life. And so I have this quote right here and it says, relax, you will become an adult. You will figure out your career. You will find someone who loves you. You have a whole lifetime. Time takes time. The only way to fail in life is to abstain. That's what I have here. And just some traveling stuff, getting married, some designer items, you know, all these different things. I wrote this so long ago. I wanted a Jeep at the time too. And I really like Jeeps. You know, no matter how much money I make, I still really, really like Jeeps. And I hope I have one day. That's kind of like one of the vision boards that I have. But now I don't really have a vision board. I have one like on my desktop and I also have one on my phone. But yeah, I never really had one that said $1 million like that. I had a sticky note though that I put in, said 7-figure business, and it's still at my mom's house and I still haven't taken it down. Another question that I have is, what business boundaries do you set for your weekends or what are your work hours? So I kind of answered this already. My work hours, I wake up at 8. I work out in the mornings. I don't really start my day until 11. Some days I started at 10, but that's mostly because we have meetings and those are the days if I'm not working out. And then I work until like 7. And so I'm pretty much working like 8 hours like everyone else. There are some days where I might work less and I might just like take the day off. And then there are other days where I'm working like 12 hours straight. And usually it's when we have a big deliverable or maybe it's a launch phase that we're going through. And so that's kind of what happens. I do sometimes still work on the weekends, but that's literally if there's like a deliverable on Monday or if I really need to catch up on work. I actually don't work that much on the weekends anymore. When I first started my business and I was a solopreneur, I worked like every single day. And I think there was a question that you guys asked on like what my schedule was like. How many hours did I work when I was a solopreneur? Oh gosh, I worked like 12-hour days or more. Before I talk about that though, this is a bronzer that I use. It's Hoola. OG. I went back to it after trying so many bronzers and realized that this is basically the best one, at least in my opinion. When I started working as a solopreneur, don't forget that I was side hustling. So I was a coffee barista. I was working graveyard shifts. So my shift started at midnight and then ended at 8 a.m. And then after that, I would like take a nap, go to sleep, and then I would work on my business. And so I worked a lot. And so that's why I also worked on the weekends too, to really catch up on work and film and all those things, because I was working my coffee shop job. After I quit my coffee shop job, I was still working a lot on the weekends because I was just really bad at time management and I didn't know what was a priority at the time. I was filming YouTube videos too. I worked a lot more hours when I started as a solopreneur. And I think that's normal. I think that when you don't have the support and you want to grow fast and you want to do that, you know, working more than 8 hours a day is not unusual in entrepreneurship. And then as you start having a team, you're able to scale up your time a little bit and delegate and have other people who are smarter than you, who are more efficient than you, do the things that you're not necessarily great at. That's kind of what that looks like. And then boundaries for my team, nobody works on the weekends unless it's a launch. And most people sign off by 5 p.m. We have some of our team members who have a similar schedule to me. They log in at 10 and then sign off at 6 or 7 or something like that. And then everyone gets a lunch break for an hour. Everyone signs off at like 12 or whenever they want, really. And so those are really the boundaries. We don't text each other about work stuff. Everything is on our Slack channel. And that's basically how it works. All right, so at this point, I've done my face. I've put my blush, my bronzer, and then sometimes I'll do like a nose contour, but today, actually, I'll just do it. I just use this brush right here, and I use the same Benefit bronzer, and then I'll dip some in, and then I'll start doing my nose contour. So while I do my nose contour, let's talk about the next question that I have, which is, what are some of your current affirmations? I love affirmations. I think that I have like changed my affirmations so many times. Like every year, I have a different one. But lately, my affirmation is I am capable of doing hard things.
And what this basically means is there's a lot of things that I suck at, you know, there's a lot of things that intimidate me. And when you're growing a business, you realize that you're doing a lot of things for the very first time. And so because you're doing things for the first time, it's so intimidating and it's really easy to be down on yourself if you don't know how to do it the first time. And so a good affirmation that I tell myself is, you know what? I'm capable of doing hard things. I'm capable of rolling up my sleeves and figuring it out. I'm capable of pushing through the pain and, you know, eventually knowing and trusting that I will figure this out and I will master this damn thing. And so that's the affirmation that I have. Another question that someone asked me is, are you happy? A new affirmation that I actually have written in my other notebook, the one that I journal in all the time, is happiness is a choice, not a circumstance. And I really, really love that, even though, yeah, it's kind of like an affirmation. And it just reminds me that, hey, I can choose to be happy anytime. And where this comes from is really the fact that over time in my business and over time as I've achieved things in my life, and I feel like I've achieved a lot of things even before this business. When I was in university, I won top female of my graduating class. And after, I was on to the next thing. I worked at L'Oreal, like such an amazing company that sells beauty products that I love. Like, that is so cool. I worked in their head office. I got to live in Montreal and I was making, you know, decent money, I think. And it was really great. And then this business, I hit my first 10K month. Then I hit my first $100,000. Then I hit my first million. And then I hit my first multiple million and all these different things. And I remember literally telling my boyfriend, I'm like, wow, like, how come I don't feel happy yet? And he was like, are you crazy? You can't just keep chasing the next thing to be happy, because now what I'm chasing in my life, and someone asked me, like, what do I want in my personal life? Like, how do I know I've made it? Why am I working so hard? I'm chasing a house. Like, I want to buy a nice house with my boyfriend and we're going to get married in and have kids. And like, then I'll be happy. Then I'll be, you know, fine. Or I want to have an 8-figure business. I want to do all these things. But in the course of my life, I realized that it will never stop. You will never be happy. You will never be satisfied. You will always want more, 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 more. And in order for you to stop that cycle is for you to realize that happiness is a choice, not a circumstance. It's not, I will be happy once I have this particular thing happen in my life. It's no matter what happens in my life, I will choose happiness today. And I feel like that affirmation has just changed my total perspective on everything. I just wanted to share that with you guys because I think it's so powerful. Onto my eyes. So usually my lashes are like way better filled, but I haven't gone to the lash tech in a while. So they're pretty sparse. It's not what I love, but we'll deal with it. And essentially the only thing that I put in my eyes is eyeshadow, and I use this color right here, so like a little highlight color, and this is from Natasha Denona. It broke, obviously, so. And what I do is I literally take my fingers and then I put it in my eyes, so that's kind of what I'm gonna do because I love highlighting my eyelids. It's just something that I like. And so while I do that, let me answer the next question. There's a lot of questions. I'm kind of like skipping through some because I know that I've been talking a lot and this is such a long video probably. The next question that I have right in front of me that I will answer is, could you have started your business if you were still at your previous job? The answer is no. I honestly don't think so. But I honestly think that it was really like ballsy and risky of me to quit without a backup plan. And that is something that I actually do not recommend for a lot of people. I sound like a hypocrite, but I would not advise people to do that. Mostly because I don't want to be liable for what happens because business is unpredictable. I don't know what that person's skill is. I don't know how bad that person actually wants it. I don't know that person's financial background, if they're in debt or if they have support from family. Like, I don't know. And so that's why I am very, very cautious of not telling people, hey, quit cold turkey, blah, blah, blah. But for me, where my privilege, like where I feel like I'm very privileged and that I think it's important for people to know about is when I quit my job, I had a place to go. I was able to move back to my mom's house, no problem. I don't pay rent at my mom's house. My expenses were literally just like feeding myself, which is why I ended up working at a coffee barista job to sustain myself. I wasn't in debt. I had no debt. I had no student loans. I had nothing like that. And so I think it's really important for me to share that. And I don't think I've shared that before, but it's you don't really know the privilege that other people have and why they're taking the risks that they're taking. And so for me, it worked well that I was able to quit my job cold turkey and start this business. But for other people who have different backgrounds, different socioeconomic like backgrounds, I guess, you know, you might not be able to do that safely. And so you need to assess that and don't just look at entrepreneurs who quit cold turkey or go from one risk to another without considering the type of privileges that they might have in life. I just want to share that with you as a disclaimer, because even though I say that I totally don't think I would have been able to start this business without quitting my job because I was just in not a good place at my job mentally, and I'm someone who's just such a people pleaser, back then I will always put my boss's affairs or
L'Oreal or whatever business I was in first before my needs. And that was because I was eager to please. And I felt like if I didn't put that first, then they would think that I didn't care, or they would think that I'm not good enough. And just all this self-worth thing that was tied to my job. And so that's why I do feel like quitting and coming back home too made a huge difference. Like, I was super homesick coming back to Vancouver, seeing my boyfriend again. We were doing long distance. Like, it made me significantly happier at seeing my pets again. Like, and that's why I really, really do not regret quitting my job. But again, I would not advise it. You need to understand that I'm very privileged to be able to do that without having any loans, any debt, any of that in my life. And a very supportive parents in terms of, yeah, you can crash. Supportive in business, that's a different story. As you can see, I put some like highlight on my eyes. That's kind of what I do. And then I'm going to put some like eyeliner with my shadows. This is the brush that I use. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to take the same eyeshadow palette and go to the darkest shade right here. And I'm just going to like use that as my eyeliner. I don't really use actual wet eyeliner anymore because I find that it is too dark and too harsh on my face. And over time, I've actually worn less and less and less makeup. If you look at my previous videos, I had like black eyeshadow, fake lashes and everything. But over time, I've just been more of a skincare girl and just stopped wearing that much makeup. And instead, I automated everything. And it has saved me so much time. But anyways, the next question that I have here is, what's your human design profile? I am a projector. I don't really know what that is, to be honest. I just know I'm a projector. The next question that I have also is, what's your favorite cuisine? Sushi, Japanese food. If I could just like live off of one type of cuisine for the rest of my life, it would probably be Japanese food. Every other 3 days, I think I have sushi. The next question I have is, what do you see your business scaling to? What is your ultimate goal? So like I said earlier, I really want to launch an e-commerce business in the future. And it's a business that's really built to be like sold one day. I think that that is like where you can really get like a multi-million dollar exit or even an eight-figure exit. But that's just like so far away. In terms of like immediate like goals that I have for this business is, I have one program called the Bossgram Academy. And so many people every single day ask me, what is your next program? And a lot of students in this program, the Bossgram Academy, always ask me, like, I want the next step. Because the Bossgram Academy aims to help people create their one-on-one services and launch their one-on-one coaching or consulting programs. Very similar to what I did when I started. And so the natural next step for a lot of my students is to package that into either a group coaching program that they can scale or a course. And so that potentially could be the next step, the next avenue. Now that my team is more established, I have more time and money to like really invest and make it good. Because the one thing you should know about me is that if I do something, it needs to be damn good. I don't like to half-ass stuff. And every time I do half-ass stuff, I feel really bad about it after. That's kind of why it's been taking me a while. And also, I just feel like with my current product, the Bossgram Academy, there's just like so much that can be improved with it in terms of like the back end, my team, the systems, our protocols and all that. Well, I'm also a really firm believer of just like taking a good product and making it great and then making it excellent. And so what you'll notice with me is I'm not so much as someone who has like a lot of, I do have shiny object syndrome, but I don't actually act upon it. Like, I have so many ideas. Like, there's a lot of people who also launch a bunch of stuff. But for me, I'd rather perfect what's working right now and making it like the number one product in the market. Like, I'm just obsessed with that. That's kind of like my philosophy when it comes to like stuff. And that's the same thing with like this business is like, I don't really want to launch my e-commerce business because I still feel like there's a lot of work to be done. And I'm just getting started with this business. I like to focus my energy on like one thing at a time, scaling it up, perfecting it, and then moving on to another thing because I feel like a lot of people have so much shiny object syndrome and they just kind of like do everything. And then when you do everything, you literally don't really master anything. And that's kind of my advice to a lot of people too, is they're always like, oh, like I need to be on this platform, that platform, Clubhouse, TikTok, podcast, YouTube, Instagram, I want to do it all. But how I was successful is I literally doubled down on like two platforms, Instagram and YouTube. And it wasn't until I actually started hiring a team was when I was able to maybe do podcasts. And even then my podcast like still isn't that consistent. Teaser, we're going to be relaunching the podcast, which I'm really excited about now that we hired more people to help me. More is not always better. And it's really important that you focus on doubling down on something, being consistent in it, mastering it, and then moving on to another. There's always going to be new opportunities that pop up. I know for me, like when Clubhouse came out, so many people were like, you need to be on Clubhouse. You need to be on Clubhouse. I would love to be on Clubhouse. I even tried TikTok. I was like, oh my God, I just got on TikTok and now you guys want me on Clubhouse. Damn it. I can barely like be consistent on this YouTube channel right now because I'm growing my business so much. I'm strategic with the eggs that I focus on in my basket. And then if I can't do it, then I hire help. And hiring takes a while. And so I'm excited to like expand to new things. Don't get me wrong. But I just want to be real with you guys that if I do everything, I'm not going to be great at one thing. And I would rather focus until I can outsource. Anyways, next step. So I just did my eyeliner, as you can see, just like a little wing and then a little bit of underneath to just make my eyes pop on camera a little bit more. And then the next thing is my favorite lip combo. This is from MAC. It's so old, but it's MAC Spice. I don't know if you guys can see. It's MAC Spice lip liner. And then this is my favorite like lip product. It's from Patrick Ta and it's like a liquid lip liner and I wear it all the time in my videos. So if you ever watch my videos, this is literally the combo that you're probably seeing. This one is called She Secure. Let me put this on. But the next question that I have is, where do you live? I'm from Vancouver, BC, Canada. A lot of people think like I live in the States because 80% of my audience literally comes from the US, but I'm Canadian. And so sometimes when like US politics happens, I'm like, I don't know what to say because I don't follow it as closely as I should. So yeah, a lot of people think I'm from the US. They're like, what's your stance on this, this, this? And I'm like, I'm Canadian, but no excuse. I should probably, you know, watch the news more and be more aware of like what's going on in the world and what's going on for you guys as well. But I'm working on it. Does your boyfriend work from home too? How do you not kill each other? So I'm gonna answer that question, but first let me just put on my lip product. Okay, so I just put my lip liner and then the next thing is I'm gonna put this liquid lipstick on by Patrick Ta. And we don't kill each other. Like I always visit him and sometimes he gets annoyed. He barely visits me because I'm always like on camera and stuff. And he's like super shy. He doesn't wanna be on camera. We work really well together. And I know that some couples, they like fight and all that. And we don't really fight. Like, is that weird? I'm not trying to be like, my relationship is perfect. But it kind of is. Like, I am just so blessed. Like, we get along so well. He's my best friend. We like don't really get mad at each other that much. And we respect each other's space. Like the whole 9 to 5 at least, or whatever hours I work, like 11 to 7. Like I'm just in my office and I'll visit him from time to time. Let's say if I'm bored, we literally meet for lunch. And then at night we watch like a movie or like a TV show together and we eat dinner. And then we just do it all over again. Our lives are literally so like routine at this point, like so predictable, which I don't know if that's a bad thing, but that's kind of it. And like, I live in this townhouse he owns, he bought and everything. And actually I had plans to buy my own, but I think we're pretty much at a stage where we're ready to potentially like buy a house together, get married and all that. And so I'm really excited for that next step in our relationship. So there's a few other questions that I have here. For instance, do you employ any of your own family? Why or why not? My makeup is pretty much done, by the way. Like this is the look, pretty natural, I would say. But if you have any questions, just like DM me. All the products I'll also link in the description box below for you guys if you guys were interested in any of the things that I said today. The question was, would I ever hire any of my family members? I actually pay my mom like every month to clean my house, or my boyfriend and I's townhouse, I guess. And the reason why I do that is she would clean it anyway. She would cook for me anyways. And now that I'm making money and all that, I just want to pay her for it. Like for a lot of you guys, your parents are probably helping you out here and there. And so for me to pay it forward, I pay them. That's kind of the way that the only like person that I've employed, but everyone else, my philosophy is I probably wouldn't mix family with business because I don't think we're there yet. I would want to shelter my family from like me being all serious and like business-like, because if you're in my family, I am so opposite of like what I portray online. I'm like disgusting. I'm like really silly. I'm like immature. I crack a lot of jokes, like a lot of inappropriate jokes. Like that's the real Vanessa, I guess. And so no, I wouldn't mix that. Another question that we have here is, what is a good time to get incorporated? A good time to get incorporated is once you start making money, but there's other things beyond just incorporation. You could be a sole proprietor. There's so many different things. So you need to talk to an accountant about that. Even if you're not making money yet, have a consultation with an accountant. Most times they're free. And then just assess your situation from there because it's different for everyone. And then another question that I want to answer is, how often do I spend time with friends and family? So I see my dad every Thursday almost. We have a scheduled lunch together at like 12:30 every Thursday at a specific restaurant that we plan in advance. And the reason why I do that now is because over time I realized that I don't spend time with my dad that much. Like before I implemented this like weekly lunch with him, I think I was seeing him like once every 2-3 months. My parents are divorced And so I don't really see him that much. I'm really happy that I've integrated this weekly lunch with him, because then it's in my schedule to see my family, or my dad at least, every single week. And then my mom, every single week, she like comes to clean as well. And then I see my mom often. I go over to her place. Like, I haven't changed my mailing address. And so I still have a lot of like mail and packages that are sent to her place. So that's an excuse for me to see her and all that. So I see my family, you know, I think more than the average person would maybe see their family, because I make the effort to. Before, I did not make the effort and I would not see them at all. But ever since I moved here, I realized I don't see my mom as much. And then as my parents are getting older, I also realized I would really regret not scheduling time to see them. Business will always be there. The email will always be there. The Slack message will always be there, but my parents will not always be here. And that like literally makes me so sad to say. And so I make an effort now. When it comes to friends, I actually try to see my friends like once every week. But obviously with COVID, it's a little bit harder to see them in groups and all of that. And I respect like COVID boundaries as well. So I don't see them as much as I would want, but I do see friends like once a week, if not every once every 2 weeks. It's not the same, obviously, because we're literally in a pandemic. What's my favorite K-drama? My favorite K-drama is Itaewon Class. Even if you don't like K-dramas, this is so good. It's about this, I don't even want to spoil it. Watch it. If you like entrepreneurship, if you like small business and that hustle and that persistence, this is so good. My favorite, Itaewon Class. This video is probably 45 to almost an hour long. This is my comeback to YouTube. This is my makeup routine, and I've shared the skincare products that I love to use. I hope that you enjoyed this video. Let me know if you would like more FAQ videos like this. If you hated this video and it was like a complete waste of time for you, then make sure you check out these two videos that I have right here. I promise these two videos are like so much more different. These are more strategy-based, business-based, but I just wanted to do this video that has been long awaited. I hope you guys enjoy. If you guys have any questions about my makeup routine or whatever, just feel free to DM me and I will see you in the next video. I hope you guys have a great week, I hope you guys have a great day, a great week, and a great life, and I will see you in the next one. This is what happens when I take a break from YouTube. I forget my outro. Bye, guys.